Hey, what's up, you guys? Welcome or welcome back to the channel. My name is Meredith. Thank you so much for being here. Today we're talking about The Short Second Life of Brie Tanner, which as you can see is not the longest book in the world. So we're not gonna be here for very long, but I'm feeling good. It's a beautiful day. It's a sunny 75 degrees here in Phoenix. I'm filming with the window open. So I do apologize if you can hear the faint rustling of trees, the beauty of nature outside the window. I went to yoga this morning. I'm watching the Bears and the Cardinals play like the worst game of football I've ever seen. And I thought, you know what? Why write a script? Why prepare anything? Let's just chat. I've been struggling to film this because I like truly don't even know what to say. The Short Second Life of Brie Tanner is a novella. It takes place in the Twilight universe. It shows the perspective of a newborn vampire named Brie Tanner, who surrendered during the Great Newborn Battle in Eclipse and was ultimately killed by the Volturi. This book essentially shows some of her time as a newborn vampire and really exists to show us what the newborn vampire army was up to while they were being trained and created. There's an introduction from Stephanie Meyer at the beginning where she goes on to say that when she's writing the first draft of each Twilight book, she's strictly in Bella's mind the whole time and she only sees what Bella can see. But as the edits go on, she starts to think from other characters' perspectives and uses that to help inform some of what happens around Bella and her perspective. And that while she was going through that process for Eclipse, she ended up really caught on this character, Brie Tanner, thinking about things from her perspective and specifically from the newborn vampire's perspective. So this book, while it came out after Breaking Dawn, takes place during the events of Eclipse and just shows the newborn army being created from Brie's perspective as one of the newborns. It's really, really short. It's 178 pages. And if you're a big Twilight fan and you've never picked this up, I actually found myself enjoying it quite a lot. One of the things that Stephanie Meyer said was her goal and why she got so stuck on this character and why she wanted to write this novella was the joy of thinking from the perspective of a vampire who views the humans as food. In the Twilight series, Bella obviously interacts with the Cullens, who are all vegetarians. They don't drink human blood. They drink animal blood. But most of the vampires in the Twilight universe do not do this. They are aware of essentially one other clan of vampires that does the same thing, the Denali clan. Every other vampire they've ever met does drink human blood to survive. And those vampires all view the humans as prey. So Stephanie Meyer says, just in the interlude at the beginning of this book, that part of what was fun about writing it was thinking from the perspective of a vampire that views the humans as prey and kind of seeing that through their eyes. And you know, I was a little bit disappointed by how little it felt like she actually explored that through the plot. I felt like the plot mostly focused around Brie and this other newborn vampire, Diego, that she bonds with. And it's implied that they're sort of leading towards becoming a couple. And then it goes from there. Let's go over the plot quickly, full spoilers, by the way, and then we can come back around and talk more about that. So we meet Brie Tanner when she's out on a hunting expedition with three other newborn vampires, one of which is named Diego. Her and Diego are the smarter of the four that are out. The other two are pretty destructive. They don't seem to care if they leave a bunch of evidence that something supernatural happened, even though they keep getting told by Riley, who's their leader, that they're supposed to hide the bodies and not make it obvious. So Diego and Brie decide, you know what, we don't want to deal with them right now. Let's sneak off and go hunt on our own. And this leads them to bond a little bit. We then see them kind of hide the bodies in the river. And then we see them start to rush back to the home base for this newborn vampire army that's being created. And they're really, really in a rush to get back. And they seem really afraid as the sun is coming up. And when they get back, they find that the house has been completely destroyed because it turns out 20 newborn vampires are pretty hard to control. So this happens every once in a while. That means that the army moved on to a new house, but they do not have time to find the house before the sun comes up. So instead they hide in this cave that Diego had dug out. And we find out that Diego and Brie both believe that if they go into the sun, they'll be just completely extinguished. They'll combust. Now we, the reader, obviously know that this isn't true. this was debunked in the first Twilight book. The vampires in this universe can go out in the sun. It's just that they're very sparkly when they're in the sun. So they do not look human. They're very obviously not human. But that doesn't mean that anything happens to them. It doesn't hurt them. They just can't go out in the sun around human beings because then they'll reveal their vampirism to them. Yet, Bree and Diego clearly believe that the sun is a danger to them. So we know Riley lied to them, but we get to watch them have a very cute interaction where they're clearly kind of flirting with each other and bonding and eventually letting a bit of the sun's rays into their hidey hole by like digging up a little bit and kind of poking their limb out into it and finding out that they can in fact go in the sun just fine. Now the newborns have not been introduced to their actual creator at any point in time other than when they're being created. They only know her as her and they don't know anything else about her. We find out later that this is very intentional. This is so that if any of them are captured, they cannot give up who created them. But Diego and Bree both start to wonder if whoever she is lied to Riley and if Riley also doesn't know that they can go out in the sun. So they hatch this plan to essentially have Diego tell Riley that they can go out in the sun just fine and they won't get hurt. But Diego decides to do it in a way that Riley would not know that Bree also knows this. And they kind of track Riley through the woods and they find this house that he lived in with Victoria. And they essentially listen to them bone. And it's especially hilarious because they talk about the sounds of them kissing and how the sounds of vampires kissing don't sound like the sounds of humans kissing because they're not fleshy, they're stone. They said it's like a clinking noise and Bree had no idea what it was and Diego has to explain to them that that's what it sounds like when vampires kiss. That's such a fun little like world building niche thing that just makes me more angry about the whole them being able to get a boner making no sense thing. Because if Stephanie Meyer has thought out the rules of this world enough to establish that because vampires are stone-like beings, when they kiss each other, it's like sounds like stones hitting each other. Like, why could she not be that exact and detailed with some of the other world building in the universe? But I digress. They overhear a bunch of stuff that means essentially nothing to them, but explains a lot to the reader about what's going on with the army and that they're prepping this army for something, which Bree and Diego did not know at the time. And then as they're watching this house and listening to the conversation going on inside, some Volturi members walk up and walk in. Now, this is very fascinating because it was implied in Eclipse that the Volturi very specifically did not show up until after the whole newborn thing in hopes that the Cullens at least would have their numbers depleted a little bit by the whole thing because the Cullens have become such a powerful coven and the Volturi feel threatened by them. However, it was not ever established that the Volturi actually were already around and like visited Victoria and fully knew she was going to attack and were already in the area and were very intentionally waiting until after the attack. Like it was always implied that they just showed up right afterwards, slowed their approach so they would arrive just in time. Maybe I'm an idiot and I didn't pick up on the fact that they were already in the area or something. Maybe that was implied and I just missed that from Eclipse, but whatever. I always thought that they had just approached slowly enough to time their arrival just on time so that the attack would have already happened. But the Volturi were already in the area, were fully aware of it, and were talking to Victoria about it and essentially told her that if she's successful in wiping out the Cullens, they might be lenient against some of her crimes with the newborn army. And they give her a few days to do so, and they say if she hasn't done it by then, that they will come back for her and wipe her out and wipe out the army themselves. So with all this new information, Bree and Diego run back to their hideout, and Diego stands outside to tell Riley what he found out. Now, we never see Diego again, and it's pretty easy to figure out that Riley ends up killing him to keep this information from the other newborns. But he convinces Bree that he just sent Diego on this like secret spy reconnaissance mission, especially because he like tells the army at this point that they were created for something. So he's like, oh yeah, I sent Diego out to like do this reconnaissance. And she just believes him and she cares so much about Diego that she trusts Riley, she believes him, and she believes that Diego is still alive. Now there's another newborn vampire named Fred who has one of the magical extra powers that vampires can sometimes have, and his power is the ability to repel attention and people from being in his space. Like he can make them kind of repulsed by him in a way that makes them not want to really approach him or even look at him. And he and Bree have this like tentative bond, And so over the course of the next few days, she mostly just hangs out with Fred, avoids the training, worries about Diego, and eventually comes to the conclusion that she and Diego should escape. Now, on the day of the actual attack, Fred is fully planning on escaping and uses his repulsion powers to help him do this. And he tries to convince Bree to go with him, but she wants to save Diego, so she goes to the battle anyway. And as the battle starts to unfold, she starts to realize that a lot of what they were told by Riley about the battle and what they were trying to do is false, and that the army is kind of falling apart. And at some point, it dawns on her that Diego is probably dead. And she decides to just try and escape the battle. Now, Carlisle catches her and is about to kill her when she starts begging for her life and surrenders to him. And you know Carlisle. He's immediately like, all right, if you don't want to fight me, I don't want to fight you. I don't want to kill you. Esme walks up and is on board with this, but then Jasper approaches. And Jasper is very much like, no, we have to wipe her out. We cannot at all make it look like we were associated with this new Bern army at all when the Volturi show up, but Carlisle convinces him and they decide not to kill her, and then the Volturi show up. Now here's where I think the most fun part of this book happens, because we see the interaction between Jane and Edward and the exchange between them through Bree's eyes. Knowing full well that Edward can read Bree's mind, Riley had told them that the Cullens had a mind reader, and at some point Bree figures out that Edward is the mind reader, and we get a really, really fun exchange where Bree is like giving Jane information but withholding some things, but very specifically thinking them so that Edward finds them out. So Jane doesn't know that Bree told Edward that Jane had visited Victoria. The only thing that was disappointing about that is that never comes up in the original four books. Like, we never find out that Edward actually fully knew not just that the Volturi had timed their approach perfectly, but that Jane had actually approached Victoria days beforehand and had like tried to encourage her to wipe out the Cullens. I feel like that's something Edward would have told the other Cullens. So unless I'm completely blanking, but I just reread those four books. I made in-depth videos about them. I feel like I would remember him saying that, and I just don't. So unless my memory just completely wiped that out, I feel like he tells everybody, yeah, their timing was really convenient. They were obviously hoping the newborn army wipes us out, but I don't remember him explicitly saying that he knew that they had like encouraged Victoria to do the attack and had almost like offered her maybe a chance for forgiveness if her army managed to kill some of the Cullens. And then Carlisle offers to take responsibility for Bree and teach her their ways so that she's not a danger. But Jane says, hey, there's no exceptions. When you break the rules, you break the rules. And so the Volturi end up killing her. And that's the end of the novella. Now, going back to what Stephanie Meyer said about being in the mind of a vampire that's actually a hunter that is hunting the humans, I wish we'd gotten more of that. I feel like that was significantly more enjoyable than reading about her flirting with Diego. And that's coming from somebody who loves romance. You guys know how much I love romance. You know how much adding a romance to a book improves it for me. We've seen that with the Stormlight Archives. And yet I felt like I wanted so much more of Bree being a vampire and so much less of her bonding with Diego. Why is that? Because as Stephanie Meyer pointed out herself in the intro, she has the opportunity to write a book from a vampire's perspective that views the humans as prey. So getting more time of her hunting humans and more of her perspective on humans, and even maybe getting to see her interact with humans at night in some way, I feel like would have been so much more of a valuable use of page space than her hiding in a cave and flirting with another newborn vampire. Like, it just felt like such a strange choice, especially given what she said in the intro she really wanted to do with this book. It is a little bit of like a tiny love story with Diego, and not really that much of Bree actually being a predator. Yes, they do a little bit of hunting, but only really the first hunting trip is shown in depth. And even when she goes hunting later in the story, it's more just kind of like brushed over, explained in like a broad stroke instead of shown in depth. I would have liked to see so much more of that. However, the things that I did find to be very cool, seeing the newborn vampire army up close and personal was also very enjoyable. It was fun to see their dynamic. It was fun to see how Riley interacted with them. It was fun to see the different ways they manipulated them, such as lying about them going out in the sun. It was also really fun to watch Bree learn to think as a vampire, for lack of a better way of putting it, because she often talks about how hard it is to think through the thirst, and when they're really thirsty, they really are very primal and very hunter-minded, and it's hard to think clearly. And she remarks that by conversing with Diego, the two of them are able to keep up a coherent train of thought together, which I thought was a fun little touch. And we see Bree figure out that Diego is dead by thinking about why Riley would lie about their ability to go out in the sun in the first place. And she sort of realizes that it's all in an attempt to control them, and that if they realized they could go out in the sun and not die, why would they come back to the base, basically? And why would they listen to anything Riley has to say? They would just all run off on their own and do their own thing, but they keep coming back to the central location because they're afraid of the sun. They're afraid of being caught out in the sun. So that's what makes her realize that they definitely intentionally lied, and that Riley probably killed Diego because he knew the truth at this point and was trying to hide it from the other newborns. It was really fun to watch all the newborns interact and to kind of see the dynamic of all of them. There are these two little gangs, almost, for lack of a better word, like within the newborn army. This guy Raul, and I believe the leader of the others is named like Kristen or something. But once again, I would have liked to see that explored more. We heard a lot about it through Bree's internal monologue, and we saw tiny spats between them. We never really saw that much of the politics of the newborn vampire space and the interactions between the two warring sides. I think all of that would have been so much more interesting than a Bree and Diego love story, especially because Diego is gone for like the back half of the book, so we don't even get that much cutesy romance. We get a lot of Bree just kind of worrying about him and not interacting with the other vampires. And I almost feel like Stephanie Meyer's biggest mistake was adding Fred so that Bree kind of had a place to hide where the other newborn vampires didn't interact with her as much. I feel like it would have been better to force her to interact with the other newborn vampires and survive by means of interacting with them instead of by hiding from them, because I just think it would have led to so much more action. Like, it's already a super short book. It's really not that long. And we spent so much of this time with Bree just hiding and like worrying about Diego and thinking about what's to come. And I think that time would have been better spent watching her interact with the other newborns and try and keep herself alive. Again, going back to what Stephanie Meyer said she wanted to do, which is show Bree as a hunter. So I'll be honest, I was kind of disappointed. I've never read this before. I picked this up specifically to make a video about it because I'm a completionist. I'm also going to be doing Life and Death in Midnight Sun, and then I will have done videos on the entire Twilight series, every book that exists within it. So that's why I picked this up, and I was actually really excited to read it because I do love Twilight, and so I was excited to read Twilight content that I had never read before. But I was honestly very, very disappointed by this. I read it in one sitting, it was really quick, I was entertained by it, but I just felt like there were so many missed opportunities and so much more that could have been done that would have been so much cooler to get to actually read from the perspective of a vampire that hunts humans. It was good, but I think it could have been so much better, and that's why I'm disappointed. Them's my thoughts. Relatively simple today. Probably a pretty short video. It was a short book. There isn't that much to analyze, really, from like a literary perspective. There's a lot of little hints dropped at stuff that happens in Eclipse, which was also really fun. So I'm not saying I don't recommend this, because like I said, it was a really quick read. I read it in one sitting and I had fun reading it. I just felt like there were so many missed opportunities that it could have been so much better. But if you're a huge Twilight fan and you have never read this, I do still think you would enjoy it. There are a lot of Easter eggs planted, kind of hinting at things that happen in Eclipse. And of course, just more time reading writing by Stephanie Meyer in the Twilight universe is always a blast. There's a short vid for you about the short second life of Bree Tanner. Sorry I don't have that much more to say. I really put off filming this for like multiple days because I kept hoping that, much like with the Joker movie, some kind of realization was gonna hit, some kind of awakening that made me realize the way I could frame the video where I'd have so much more to say. But nothing hit. This is really forgettable. It's getting a bit cloudy out. Sorry if the lighting's changing. I love you guys, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!